So good morning, everyone. I won't be starting quite yet, but this is going to be about the Drupal 8 theming experience, so if you're expecting something else, feel free to find the other session. So how many of you were at Morten's session yesterday? Okay, pretty good amount, thank you. That's good. Did you learn a lot? Good stuff. And by the way, once I get to the coding, there's a little bit of code in this, not too much, but there's some. It might be a little bit hard to see with the lighting and everything, but there's a URL there. You can open it on your laptop or your phone or whatever, and you could follow along that way if you like. You don't have to, but it might be helpful. So it's bit.ly/d8txdca16. And also, if you go to the page for this session on the DrupalCon Asia website, there is a PDF and a link to the slides as well. So if you don't want to type all that out. Okay, so this feels like a good time to start. So thank you everyone for coming. It's really nice to be in India. I used to work as core mentor on IRC for about 2 years, and I worked with a lot of people from India, so it's really nice to actually be here and meet some more of these people that I've met online. So thank you all for the hospitality and welcome. So this is about the Drupal 8 theming experience. It's kind of a newer session, so if you've seen any of my sessions before, this will be a little bit different. There may be a little bit of overlap, but it's mostly new stuff, so hopefully you can learn something from this. So before we get started, I just want to tell you a little bit about myself. And by the way, can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
In the back? Not too loud? Good? Okay, thank you. So my name is Scott Reeves, also known as Kotzer. I'm one of the co-maintainers of the Drupal 8 theme system and working with Twig and all those fun stuff, and also the current maintainer of the stable-based theme in Drupal 8. And pretty recently, I'm also provisional Drupal 8 core committer for front-end and theming. So, thank you. I've made, I think, 2 commits so far, so it's pretty fun. I'm also a team lead at Digital Echidna. We are a 40-person Drupal shop out of London, Canada. And as you can see from my picture, I used to be a pilot as a child. So before we start, I just want to talk about a couple sort of concepts, because the title of this is the Drupal 8 theming experience, and it's kind of a little bit of a play on words, because I want to talk about the themer experience. So these two things, themer experience, TX themer experience and DX developer experience, are tags that we use to categorize issues on Drupal.org. You could think of these as similar to user experience, but the user is a themer or a developer. And themer is kind of a weird thing. We might call it a Drupalism. It's more so in previous versions of Drupal. We've made it a little bit more defined in Drupal 8, but it's still a hybrid role, And the themer is often responsible for design, CSS, JavaScript, templating, maybe some PHP. Who knows what else? Much respect to all Drupal themers. You don't have an easy job, so give yourselves a round of applause. So, like I said earlier, I've been involved with Twig and things like that. So I actually started getting involved with Twig and Drupal 8 in about spring of 2013. And I was like, yes, Twig, it's going to solve all of our problems. But as I quickly found out, there was much more to it than that. Just converting things to Twig is not really the full answer. Yes, it's a big improvement over PHP template, like rest in peace, PHP template. Well, not really. Good riddance, PHP template. Twig got me really excited about getting involved, but in the end, like, there was a lot of other changes. For example, like, in the previous versions of Drupal, we have pre-process and we have process, and it's kind of confusing. Like, you know, it's not always clear which one you're supposed to use, so we just have pre-process now. So that's just one example. I'm not going to go over all of them, but I'm just going to go over a few things. There's documentation if you want to learn about all of the changes in Drupal 8 theming. If you really, really want to learn every little thing, you can also look at the change records, although by this point, a lot of them are probably really out of date, so documentation is probably better. If you find there's lacking documentation, please help us to make it better. So in this talk, I'm going to be covering more about not really necessarily all of the changes, but how we designed these things, how we made these decisions about what we're going to change in Drupal 8, and hopefully help you to learn to work with these things, because they're different from Drupal 7. It's new things, but we want you to learn to work with this instead of like fighting and trying to still do things the whole way. Like, Drupal 8 is a shift in thinking. If you keep thinking and like working in the same way as Drupal 7, or if you're trying to like convert everything one-to-one from Drupal 7, like, you won't be happy. It's better to start fresh. New ways open up new possibilities, so I think it's a great time to embrace that and see what new possibilities it has in your work and just for playing with stuff. The other theme of this talk is the idea that individuals and small groups can have a big impact, in this case on Drupal. All the things that I'm going to be talking about today are things that were added in Drupal 8 and driven by just passionate community members, like just small groups of people, small discussions, and like, yes, we want to change this. So if you're thinking of coming to the sprint on Sunday, like, please do. Even if you just have like ideas, that's great. Like, we need ideas. Like, Morten is like our idea person, and we need more idea people, so yeah. Yeah, we need sane people as well. So you just come and join us, even if you just want to chat about things. Especially if you've already started playing with Drupal 8, we would love to hear your feedback. And maybe there's some pain point that you keep running into, and maybe we can kind of come up with a way to make that better. And by the way, if things get really confusing, like, feel free to like wave your hand if I'm going too fast or something. Like, let me know. I'm fine with that. I'd rather you kind of get more value out of this, and if you have a question, chances are someone else does too. So I'm going to cover a few things. I'm going to talk really quickly about the core base themes. For those of you that were at Morten's session yesterday, he already did a good coverage of this. And I'm going to talk about the without filter and sort of what that does and why we added it. I'm also going to talk about the Twig theme registry loader. This is kind of a mouthful. It's a lot of words. I'll explain it later, don't worry. And then also working with libraries and some of the really cool new capabilities that we have with libraries. So for the base themes, if you've heard of the, well, how many people have heard of the DrupalCon Austin Consensus Banana? Few people? Yeah, okay. Anyway, it's a weird name, but it was basically a discussion group of around like 20, 30 people at a DrupalCon a couple years ago, and trying to figure out, you know, what can we do with the markup to make it better, because we were kind of struggling for a long time and like we couldn't agree on how to do things. So we kind of figured out I mean, the proportions are not exact or anything. This is, it's maybe like 3/4 and 1/4. It's tough to say, but they're more like, think of them more like personas. So we have the sensible 2/3, and these people, they maybe don't want as many dibs as you had in Drupal 6 and Drupal 7, but they still kind of want like classes. Like you could have like a node --article class or something like that to say that you're on an article node and things like that. And then the clean 1/3 is very, very minimal. Basically, you just have wrappers and things, and if you need a class, you add the class, and you would work with the variables that are in the template to add whatever you need. I would say most people are probably going to use Classy. That's the sensible. And by the way, if you fall into the clean part, we're not saying you're not sensible, so don't be offended, please. So if you want a little bit more help and doing your CSS and stuff, I would recommend use Classy. If you really, really want like bare bones, minimal stuff, or maybe you're writing a base theme, Stable might be a good choice for you. And to use these in your info file for Classy, you put base theme Classy in your info YAML file. And for Stable, you just do nothing. Stable is the default, so you might kind of wonder why Classy isn't the default if it's the majority. The short answer is it's complicated. And the long answer is I'm not going to get into it. So Stable is a backwards compatibility layer. It's a snapshot of markup so that we can continue to evolve the markup in core and keep making it awesome for future versions of Drupal. And just in case you're wondering, Classy inherits from Stable, so so Stable. If you're feeling really dangerous or you just want to see the core markup, you can set base theme to false in your info YAML, but I really wouldn't recommend it because the core can change pretty quickly, so it can break your site. If you build a live site and put it to production with base theme false, like, and then start to upgrade to Drupal core, your site might get pretty broken, so that would be bad. Another shift is that there's more powerful things you can do in the Twig templates. So classes are generally in the templates now instead of pre-processed, which was like a really wild idea to us a few years ago. But I'm pretty happy with how it ended up, and overall people seem to be getting along pretty well with. It's a lot easier to modify and work with all these classes and things. You can also do cool stuff like attach libraries, and we have this fancy new attributes object where you can add classes and remove classes and do things with attributes, and it's very cool and powerful, and like, if you're familiar with jQuery, it's a little bit similar to that in the syntax and stuff. If you want to learn more about what you can do with templates, and maybe you missed Morten's session yesterday, or you just want to kind of relive it, if you go to the slides, the little asterisk star links to Morten's talk from that camp last year. So yeah, check that out. And just to kind of stop on a concept here, additive versus subtractive. So this kind of came up a couple times with different things that we were working on. For the clean 1/3 of people, it's really problematic and kind of error prone to try and remove all the classes that you don't want. It's a lot better to be additive, and other than you don't have to use nasty things like regular expressions to remove out all of the markup and classes that you don't want. So it's easier to start with almost nothing and then build up. And these concepts also apply to how we integrated Twig itself into Drupal. We didn't want to change Twig too much because we wanted Twig to feel sort of, Twig in Drupal to feel sort of familiar to people who are maybe working with Symfony or any other frameworks or CMSs that use Twig. And like, we want it to be familiar for them. So we added some few things, but we didn't really take away anything. We maybe changed a few small things, like for auto escape related, but mostly kept it the same. So now I'm going to talk about the without filter. You might remember show and hide in Drupal 7, but this won't work. This kind of looks like Drupal 8 code. It used to be Drupal 8 code, but we killed it because it's not good. So the show and hide, they manipulate a render array. They manipulate the printed property, the hash printed of a render array. It's very confusing. You kind of have to keep track of what the state of the render array is, as opposed to just like kind of getting what you want. The other problem with show and hide is that they were a real pain to implement in Twig. We had to create these crazy, not me personally, but kind of Twig team, create these like crazy Twig reference objects and be like, oh yeah, we're gonna like add it in there and pull it out. And it's just, because Twig doesn't really work with things by reference. So anyway, we had to come up with another solution. So we did the, instead of show and hide, we have now the without filter. We actually got the inspiration for this from another CMS that's also using Twig called Craft CMS. So I think that's a great example of like using other tools, kind of getting into bigger ecosystems, allowing us to kind of just do more things and do things in a more standard way somewhat. So both of these examples print out the same things, actually. But as you can see, I mean, I think so anyway, that the second example is a lot clearer what you're actually doing, especially if you take out all the code comments and everything. So, all right, now we're gonna make sense out of the Twig registry loader. So, before we made this change, there were two ways to reference a Twig template from your template. So if you're doing things like extending, which I'll show an example of in a minute. So the first way is by namespace of the modular theme. So in this case, it's using the stable base theme. So you do @stable /block/block.html.twig. The second way is using the full path from the Drupal root, which is pretty ugly. So core theme stable blah 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 blah. The namespace loading just maps to the templates directory, in case you're wondering, because it kind of looks like the first one is missing the templates directory, but it's because your Twig templates are always in the templates directory. It's always consistent. At one time, we only had the second method. So if you started using that in all your Twig templates and then you decided you wanted to move your theme or move your modules or something, you would have to adjust the paths in all your templates. So it was a little bit of an improvement, but as I'll show you, we had room to improve more. So Twig blocks. Twig has its own concept of blocks. We call them Twig blocks so we don't confuse them with Drupal blocks. We didn't want to try and rename Drupal blocks. They've been around for a lot longer than we had Twig and Drupal, so we thought about renaming Twig blocks to something like Twig block, like the little tag block. By the way, I don't know if people can see that too well at the back. Yeah, no?
No.
No? Okay. Well, like I said, you can get the link to the slides on the DrupalCon website, so that might be easier to follow along. So, yeah, so this example is showing the Twig block here inside of the Drupal block template, just to, you know, exercise your brain a little bit this morning. So we have a Twig block inside of a Drupal block, and inside of the Twig block, we're just printing the content of the block, and that's it. But what that does is allows us to extend this template and then override only this part of the template. So this example below, this is another template, separate template from the block template, like a more specific block template, let's say, and it extends the first template. So it extends the stable themes block template, and then it overrides the content Twig block, and all it does is add a wrapper. That fancy little parent function is just printing the whole contents of the parent block. So it's kind of, in this case it's probably overkill, but it's just kind of an excuse to show some like cool Twig magic. So let's say you're starting to build out your theme. You have like your info file, you have starting to build out some templates, you have like your page template, you have And let's say you want to override the markup of your search form. So you have like a little search form in your header or sidebar or something. And let's say for some reason you just need an extra wrapper around the content. So you create like a template override, and you just say, I want to add a class of block search form wrapper around the content of that block. And then later on, you decide to override all of the blocks in your theme, not just the search form block. But now, your search form block is still referencing the parent theme. Your search form block is still like extending from the parent theme, not from your theme. You may want to do this, you may intend to do this, but you may also forget about it, especially as you start to grow and get more templates, and things might get out of sync. You might wonder why my block.html.change, sorry, my block.html.fig changes are not showing up on my search form block, but are showing up on all my other blocks. So this is, again, showing the same stuff. But yeah, we're still extending the parent theme. And I was like, okay, this is great. We have the namespace method. We still have to specify the whole path. Like, what more do you need? But there's a person in the Drupal community named Mark Drummond said that we were talking, I think, on IRC, and he said, like, what if we didn't have to specify anything? We could just say, I'm extending the block template, and it would just figure out what you mean. And I was like, well, I don't know. We have a lot of other things to do, like we have to convert everything. So I wasn't so sure about this. And at the time, we didn't know it was going to be like another 1.5 years before Drupal 8 would come out. So we're like, no, like we have to get it done. We have no time. So anyway, he convinced me eventually. So this is how you do it. You just say, I extend block.html.twig. And what this does is it looks up in the Drupal theme registry which template to use. So if you have the block template in your theme, it will use that. Otherwise, it will go to the parent theme. If it's not in the parent theme, it will go to, you know, maybe the grandparent theme or the module, whatever. This is a really good way to mix the two worlds of Drupal and Twig, in my opinion, because the Drupal land has template overrides, and Twig land has like extending, and we can do like things to make things kind of cleaner or seem cleaner anyway. So yeah, so that's pretty cool. So this is kind of what I would recommend as the preferred order when you're referencing, when you want to do these Twig extending. So number one, whenever possible, just use the template name. In some cases, that won't work. If you're overriding a template that declares a Twig block and you want to extend that, like in our block template example, if you just say, I'm block.html.twig and I extend block.html.twig, it will try to extend itself, and that's an infinite loop. So if you run into that, hopefully we'll have like an exception or something soon so that you kind of know what you did, but if you run into that, you can use the second method where you just call up to the parent theme and grab the template from there, because that's kind of what you mean in that case. You don't want to extend your own template. And then, yeah, I really can't think of a reason, excuse me, why you would use number three, but it's still okay. And this is the first shout out. This is for David Wong, who's right here today, actually, which is nice, AKA Eatings. So after this was committed, people were tweeting about this, and he said, like, oh, I thought it would always work like this. Like, this is good stuff. If you ever see some like changes happening in Drupal and you like are really excited, like please tell us, like tweet or post in issue queues, like especially in this case, like when we weren't so sure, this was like really good validation for us and especially for me, because like I spent a lot of hours working on this and I was like, you know, I hope this is good, because like in core development there's often a lot of hypothetical situations. You're like, oh, like how will people actually use this? Like we kind of have to like dream up these scenarios. So this was really appreciated, so thank you. All right, now let's talk about libraries. So before I jump into this, I just want to say libraries, I think, are really great. And I think they're like pretty much as big of a change as Twig. I don't know, that might be, that's what I think. So they're a big evolution, but they're an evolution of like hook library and Drupal 7, which I wasn't really that familiar with, to be honest. I used it like a couple times, but not very much. By the way, if you download the slides or something, the little asterisk is linking to a good documentation page on Drupal.org where you can learn a lot more about this. I'm not really going to cover the basics, other than kind of explaining what this is and then showing some examples of the powerful stuff you can do now that we're using libraries. So one thing that is really cool is dependencies. So out of the box, Drupal 8 for anonymous users doesn't load any JavaScript at all. This is really nice because it's like lightweight. However, if you have a cuddly slider and you need jQuery for your cuddly slider, you need to say dependencies core slash jQuery. Otherwise, your cuddly slider will be a broken slider.
Is there any way you can make any of this stuff that you're not receiving?
Unfortunately, not really. The slides are on the DrupalCon Asia website. But yeah, it's...
You can make a cluster.
Yeah. But it's going to break everything. Normally this works better, but I probably should have done dark on light for this venue. I didn't really know it was going to be like this, so I apologize. But hopefully you can follow along on the website or check it out later. So dependencies are great because you don't have to mess with weights. Weights are really annoying if you have to mess with them in Drupal 7. Drupal 8 libraries are everywhere, so just embrace them. They're also namespace, so if you have a library name like cuddly slider, or if you have file names of like CSS or JavaScript within your library, they don't have to be unique anymore. Like in previous versions, if you had like node.css, it had to be like different, or node.theme.css or whatever it was. And this was actually the reason why Morton's patented FOID technique worked in previous versions of Drupal, is because like you can only have one with a certain name, so it's nicer to not have that because it could be really confusing. And you can still make things FOID. So this is another example of like small handful of people like came up with this, and like basically one person built the libraries overrides and the libraries extends. Before we had this, it would have been like a lot of custom PHP if you wanted to actually do these things in your theme, so this is really great. Style sheets remove and style sheets override do exist, but they're deprecated. Like I said, libraries are everywhere. I would recommend embracing libraries, go this way. My kind of tip for doing these easily is like, you can kind of see it's, maybe you can't see, but anyway, it's kind of nested to show a library that you're overriding, and then like CSS component, and it's like kind of looks like a lot. But if you actually go to, in this case, the classy.libraries.yaml, you can kind of just copy that and then copy that into your info file, and it becomes a lot easier. I don't know if that makes sense, but maybe when you start to work with this, it'll click. So when we set it to false, we're just removing. So you can override and say remove. One thing I would say is be careful about removing JavaScript. You might break stuff. So CSS is usually pretty safe, but you can remove an entire library, and the library can contain CSS and JavaScript, so just be a bit careful. You can also, with overrides, you can specify a path to CSS or JavaScript in your theme to override things. Now, one of the really cool things, I really wanted like this libraries override. And like, there's really practical usages that I didn't really realize when we were working on the issue on Drupal.org, because like I said, it's like hypothetical a lot of the time. But when we started building real sites in Drupal 8, I realized that you could basically have jQuery update in like four lines in your info file. So whenever jQuery 5000 comes out, and it's like so new, so shiny, you don't really need jQuery update, you don't need a module in your info file, you can just say, libraries override, core jQuery, and then just give it jQuery 5000, clear your cache, and you're good. So that's pretty cool. For today, maybe a more useful thing, I don't know how many people use Modernizer? Good amount, awesome. So Same thing, you can override modernizer. So core ships with its own build of modernizer, and you can override it with your own custom build. The only thing to keep in mind here really is to remember to be additive, because core needs certain tests and things in the modernizer build. So start with the core build and then add the things that you need. Another cool thing you can do is extend libraries. So you can have your theme's library load whenever another module or theme's library is loaded. So this is really useful for like conditional loading. If it's only for like a certain case or a certain like module, you can just kind of add your own styling or JavaScript or whatever on top of that. So it's kind of like the reverse of dependencies, because you're kind of saying like, no, like I'm gonna come after and like kind of tack on to your thing. And this is just like me giving a shout out, because like I said, there's basically one person who built all this. So yeah, NEBS Udo, I'm probably not pronouncing that name correctly, but yeah. Let's give him a round of applause. Because like I said, it would have been a lot of painful, like, tarot your hair or PHP, so this is much nicer. And I want you to remember, Drupal 8 is not done. It may be out, but there's room for more. Like I said, come to the sprints on Sunday, come with your ideas for Drupal 8.1.x, 8.2.x, whatever, Drupal 9, doesn't matter. All these ideas came from just like small groups of people. You don't need to be a coder. You just need to be able to think about stuff and like come with your feedback, and it's all fine. We could really use your help. Thank you. So we have plenty of time for questions. I tend to leave a lot of room for questions. The only other thing I want to mention is, please, if you can find the time, please evaluate my session on the DrupalCon Asia site. It helps a lot, especially because this is a newer session for me. So please give your feedback. Tell me, you know, what you learned, or maybe what you wanted to learn and didn't learn. Anything, it's fine. Be honest. I don't mind. Any questions? Thoughts? Hopes and dreams? Oh, we have one. Okay. Great. Way is, in cases like that, I would maybe tend towards a simpler solution, and maybe just actually take, like, remove the menu.css and just take the parts that you need and add it to your theme. Because it sounds like otherwise it might get quite complex. Like, you can do things like you could make your CSS depend on the menu CSS or the menu library, but yeah, I think, especially when it comes to like CSS, like specificity and stuff, I would probably just keep it simpler. So, from my opinion, I would say if you can get away with it, just use Clasier Stable. I think, in my opinion, the landscape is a little bit similar to around when Drupal 7 came out, where there's not really a lot that's like really good in the base themes. So rather than wait, I would suggest to just use one of the core base themes, because they're pretty reasonable. Like, you have the HTML5 markup, and with all the new capabilities of core, like, you have breakpoints and you have like responsive images and all stuff like just in core. So that's kind of my recommendation, but do your own research as well and keep an eye on things. Thank you.
I had a question that is, how does the library override and library extend work with the library alters? Like, if you have multiple library overrides in different themes, multiple library extends, like, what is kind of like the order of them being proceeded? Like, how can you alter the libraries, and how does it affect, like, at which point is that happening?
Yeah, I would say I'm not super, super honest, but, or sorry, I'm not super, super familiar with, like, exactly where it is, but it basically, it has its own, like, hook library alter. So it comes in fairly early, I think. Like, when you do it through the info file, like, it's basically cached. So I think if you also did like a hook library info alter in your theme, you would already have the stuff that you did in your info file. I don't know if that helps. Okay. But when in doubt, try it and see.
I want to ask, like, you the library URLs, right? And let's say we have a couple of base case condition where we would actually try and override both same library at two different places. So is there a way that we can control the order which takes over first and
Sorry, so two different libraries?
No, same library is being overridden at two different places.
So what do you mean by places? Like, do different
pages or? So I'm not sure. I mean, what I mean is same library is being overridden at two places.
Overridden in two places.
Yeah.
Okay. So sorry. Can you kind of repeat?
So you have a single library.
Yeah.
And it's being overridden at two places. So maybe two different silos, it's extended by something. And at other place, it's been overridden by a different thing. So how do you control the execution of which overrides first and which overrides last? Or is it even possible?
No, it's not impossible. I think even when it's set to false, it's still kind of there in the sort of array of libraries. Like, if you want to do like a PHP hook, like hook library info alter, even if you set to false, I think it's still there. So you can still kind of add things back. But once something is overridden once, it'll kind of change that. So it'll maybe, if you're taking one like CSS file and changing it to another, you know, it'll kind of save that in the library definitions. So if you, when it comes time to your next override, you may actually have to use the path of the second kind of library override. So it can get a bit complicated. One thing that we probably want to do as well with these is at least add like a namespace, so you can say like at name of theme and like specify the path that way, because right now with the stable theme, sometimes to override things, like to override like a specific CSS file, sometimes you need to specify like a big long path to like stable themes, blah, 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 blah. Because stable theme is actually, if you look at, maybe I should just bring it up. If you look at the stable, no, it's not there. Hold on, just one sec. Okay, never mind. Anyway, if you look at the stable themes info file, you'll see that it has like a lot of library overrides. So you're basing it off of that, so it's already doing overrides, so you just kind of have to, you know, keep that in mind when you're doing your own.
So why I ask this, it's kind of similar with what we have faced with vSAN, like you have similar hooks within two different modules, and then it becomes really main to actually decide on which hooks takes off, if you have similar hooks, you know, basically. Because then you see the module way and which hook is still okay. So when you use the game, has to decide which takes off the first and which last, right? Because then algorithmically sorts out which modules has gone, you might want the later on to actually be executed first and all those things.
Yeah, like in that case, it kind of sounds like you maybe want a separate library instead of always using the same library. If you have all these modules that are working with it, especially because you can do like libraries extend and things like that. So maybe one module could like extend it with its own library instead, if that is possible for your use case. In general, I would kind of discourage modules from doing too much with CSS. In terms of like overriding libraries, because if you're creating a module, like especially contrib module, like you can make things really complicated for people if you're like overriding libraries and they don't know about it and they're trying to also override libraries. So
I was just giving the reference to some situation happened in this thing.
Yeah, sorry. So I don't know if that really answers your question, but hopefully it gives you some things to think about.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Professor, I have an added question to that. I mean, like, we can prioritize, like, yesterday I was sitting with the Kepler sessions.
Yeah.
So there is a events we can prioritize, higher events comes in the, but it's a priority number in the library. Kepler is there. It's just like that we can prioritize the library which has to be loaded.
Yeah, like, I
just want to ask you, the Kepler also, like Kepler was telling yesterday, the events can be loaded according to the priority setting. So we can load the library like that. Are you able to? So one JavaScript file, I want to load it separately from, suppose, like Colorbox. So I don't want to use the Ajax from the basic what we having it. So I want to load the my JavaScript library. This has to be loaded first.
Yeah, so I think you would declare a dependency.
Yep.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. If I'm understanding.
What will do in that case? How can we do that?
So maybe I misunderstood, but I think like for your library. So sorry, does your library depend on Colorbox or the other way?
The other way.
Okay, Colorbox depends on your library.
Yeah, I have certain things to be customized.
But you want that loaded before or after Colorbox?
Yeah, before.
Before. Yeah. Okay. So. And are you declaring a Colorbox library or someone else?
Me.
You. Okay, so you just declare, you create two libraries. You have Colorbox library and then you have your custom whatever.
Okay.
And then in your Colorbox library, you say dependencies, you know, my other library, and then it will load that stuff first.
.tick files, right? With the HTML template.tick files.
Yeah.
I don't think so that's the best way.
To attach libraries?
Yes.
Oh, well, sometimes it is, because if you know that the library is only needed when that Twitch template is rendered, then you're optimizing and you're only loading it when needed,
okay,
instead of always loading it.
Okay, thanks.
So, yeah, it just depends, but it's up to you.
Thank you.
It is just, I,
to that, it's also possible to add additional parameters for a JavaScript file when it's being loaded, and you can specify a weight, which can be minus, so you can set like minus 1000, and it's going to be loaded then before anything, but that's not really the suggested way, because it's not something that you can really trust on, because anyone can always set higher or lower priority, so I think that the Scott's way to use the dependencies is the better way, because the dependencies are used to create the priorities automatically, but there is other way if you can't figure it out.
Yeah, I just like the dependencies because it kind of figures things out for you.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
You meant service workers to our team. So how can we do that?
Sorry, service workers?
Service workers.
No idea. I wish you luck.
So, I just want to grab what Todd, Jesus Christ, I'm tired of it. Anyways, Todd said early on that tomorrow, through the whole code screen and stuff, that one of the things we've used done the last 3 or 4 years has been at each DrupalCon looking at, we've been finding a whiteboard somewhere. I'm kind of famous now for taking over a whiteboard and discussing with people for hours. We really need new ideas for this. We need a lot of people who have an opinion or an idea or help us out figuring out which way we want to push the theming. There seems to be a concept or idea that we know what we're doing. We really don't. We're just improvising, just as all of you guys do it. We've just done it for a lot of years. So we really need input tomorrow, and this is my open invite to come in. Play around with us. Even if you don't even hope stuff, that's just be in the room and have the discussion and put in ideas and talk about what we want to push through 8.1, 8.2, 8.3. There's so many things we don't even know yet that we're going to put it in. Scott said earlier, a lot of these things comes because we talk with each other. So it's extremely important that we get people to show up tomorrow. And even the dumbest questions are actually the best questions, because that's also figuring out where we want to change stuff in the future. So it's actually, if you put in like an hour tomorrow, that's going to save you like a week of work in about 2 years. It's kind of strange to think it that way, but putting in the time now is actually going to save you in the future. And those kind of issues you have, figure out how to do this, how to do that, why don't we have a CSS close switch, or all these different concepts. If we have them, we know what we can do with them. We're a pretty tight group around the Drupal Trick project, but we want to have more people in. And right now, we're basically Northern Europeans and Canadians. That's kind of the people behind it. It would be pretty sweet if we actually make it into a worldwide project. That was just a bunch of white dudes and kind of need some color. And some pretty badass chicks, by the way. Sorry for that. I'm going to get my ass kicked afterwards. Anyways, come tomorrow, pretty please, help us out. I need more ideas, and I need sane people. And I've met enough sane people, also people. It's not so sane, but that's good. Yeah. Anyways.
Service workers is probably a really good example of something that hasn't really been considered. We've thought through how to really support that. So if you're interested in talking about how we could support that engineer. I just looked it up, and the JavaScript container has been one commit on the model of an experimentation of how it could work. That's something that we could work on tomorrow.
Awesome. Okay, I think we have one more question over there. I don't know if there's still a mic over there. Yeah.
Hello. Yes, I have a question here.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
I'm trying to port a Drupal 7 theme to Drupal 8, and it's a contributed theme used by many sites, and according to Drupal.org, maybe more than 12,000 sites.
Okay.
So in Drupal 7, the way the main menu as any site branding and a couple more things was shown, it was using PHP code inside of the template files.
Yeah.
That by directly using functions and variables. Now in Drupal 8, site branding and the local menu tabs, that is tabs, we have blocks for them.
So from
what I've been working, I've experienced that two ways to do that would be, first would be to create quick variables using pre-process functions and using those variables to show the branding and the tabs. Another way would be to create two new regions in which I can use the already available blocks. Being that this theme is used by a lot, by so many sites, and they would want to port to the Drupal 8, and what should I do in this case? Because introducing two new regions seems the Drupal 8 way, and using quick variables seems like Drupal 7 way.
I think if you can, I would like to discuss that with you after, because it's a very specific question, I think. And then the only other thing I want to mention, not to discourage you, but just like I said earlier, like a lot of people moving to Drupal 8 will be starting fresh, so they may, yes, use the same theme, but they may not. Again, not to discourage you, but if you can, please come up after, and we can talk about it in detail.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. And over here?
Can you extend everything in base theme to sub-theme in Drupal 8?
Can you extend everything?
Yeah. Like in Drupal 7, we cannot extend regions and tab icons like that, right?
Like do you mean from the info file?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much the same. So you can't extend, but you can kind of copy it and add your own. So I don't know if that's what you're asking, but like, I know when I first started doing Drupal 7 theming and I was using base theme, I just wanted to add the regions, but it doesn't inherit the regions. You just need to re-specify all of the regions. Does that help?
Same as Drupal 7.
Yeah, I think it's the same. So you just need to copy into your info. Yeah, thank you. Over here.
Yeah, I just want to mention that Dan Callahan from Mozilla presented on service workers, yesterday. Didn't really tie it to Drupal, but maybe you can pull him into something tomorrow, the Service Workers Society, and get something happening.
Service Workers Society, wow. Does it sound like it has a secret handshake or something? Cool, thanks for that. Any other thoughts, questions? We have like, I think a few more minutes, but if not, that's okay too. You can like frolic in the wilderness. That's good too. All right, thanks everyone for coming and thanks for sticking around.
Somebody had my thoughts.